Hello, everyone, and welcome back. It is time for episode 43 of the Rocket Punch Cast with a new friend joining us.
Hi.
This is Chaz.
Hello.
Say hello, Chaz.
Hi.
This concludes Chaz's hello. And, of course, we have Cameron.
Hey, guys.
And Will.
Yo, what's happening?
I'm Seth. We're here to talk about video games into these microphones. So, this is normally where I would ask how we've been doing, what we've been playing. We're done with that.
We're throwing it out the
this
window.
This is done. This week, there's only one thing that matters.
Does it involve Ninty?
Nintendo.
I was going to say.
Switch. Like, So we're going to mix it up here. We're going to switch our normal.
Yeah, I'm waiting for the puns. I'm waiting for the puns.
Strap in. We got an hour and a half here, baby. So we're going to be talking about Nintendo Switch basically most of this podcast. Mm. This is a huge thing, and we've actually talked about what was previously called the NX.
Yep.
Almost too much. It was too much, yeah. I would say. So we're going to talk about, there are three things to this that I want us to kind of discuss, and the first one is, of course, the hardware. We finally got a look at it through the reveal video, and if you haven't seen the 3-minute reveal trailer, we will attach that in the podcast notes so you can go to rocketpunchgo.com, scroll down a little bit on the episode page, and you will see a link to that. They showed the hardware off. They showed some software off, so I want to talk about software as well. But one thing they didn't show off that much was some of the services. We've been working so far with, we've seen some of the Nintendo, what do they call it now, Nintendo Network?
My Nintendo, whatever
they're calling it. How is that going to play into this new Switch console? Mm. So let's get kickstarted off. Hardware. What do we think about it?
I need this in and around my house everywhere.
All the time?
Always.
Okay.
In fact, when it comes out, the first podcast that we have, I'm just going to be playing it while you guys talk about things.
Okay.
I'll just be over here on the side.
You're just going to not be here. You'll be there.
I mean, I'll be here, but I won't. You get it? Like,
So what do you think? Like, what does everyone think about the, I hate to say the gimmick, but it's Nintendo. I mean, like, it's the switch, the clicking.
I mean, coming from it from a Nintendo fan standpoint, whenever you have, like the Wada asks, or whenever you like look at the old concepts for the Wii U, you know, it was just two Wiimotes strapped onto the side of an LCD screen. And so this seems sort of like the culmination of all those years of R&D. Like, the Wii U was a good experiment to see whether or not gamers would actually want to play on a gaming tablet. And it seems to be like, okay, the proof of concept, like the iPod click wheel versus the, like, you know, iPod touch kind of type transition. Mm-hmm. And so it just sort of seems like it's a... This is a long time coming, but is it too little too late? Which is the thing that we're after. It's not figure what's going on.
This is Nintendo here. This is Nintendo.
These are the people that single-handedly pulled gaming out of what would have been the recession of the arcade crash.
1984. Yeah. People keep bringing that up like it's a thing.
Oh, okay, yes. What about you, Cameron? What do you think about the design?
It's cool. More information needs to be brought as far as from a hardware perspective. The design is cool. I don't know if it's necessarily going to click like that. Like that, I think that's more of just like
a
commercial gimmicky click.
Oh no, that is total marketing.
Yeah, I feel like that's a big marketing thing there. Questions that, as far as from a hardware perspective, that need to get answered. I think they've been answered to some extent, but where are all the guts? Is it all in the tablet? Is there any type of additional power coming from
the
dock?
According to the patents that have been found, like, there's like GPUs in the dock and in the tablet. It's powered by a Tegra, so.
Okay, because yeah. That's
off of NVIDIA's website.
Just the way the video showed, now granted, you are going to be pushing resolution to a lower screen on the controller. I'm curious what that resolution is going to be. It's got to be 1080.
I think that screen is 720.
720?
Okay. I think I remember seeing... Now, that's not confirmed. Mm-hmm. There's not a lot out there.
It's based on, like, leak specs and stuff.
I would actually rather it be 720 and run well than to try and push for 1080.
I'd agree.
Not only that, I mean, 720 on that small screen, you're not going to see that much of a difference. Let's be real.
I agree with Chaz. This is... to me, the system is very much the culmination of what did we learn from the Wii? What did we learn from the Wii U? Now kiss.
You're forgetting the pinch of 3DS that's in there.
A very small pinch, but it's in there nonetheless.
I really do hope, though, that it separates itself from the 3DS. Like, the 3DS is its own thing. It was a very successful thing, but like
60 million plus.
But it needs to be more than just that. Like, you know, we were talking earlier about how Nintendo perfected sort of the near-field communication stuff between the 3DSs, where you can have two 3DSs in a room and talking to each other. If they can take that technology that they learned from the 3DS and apply it to where we're all sitting around here playing local multiplayer and not having to go through some sort of network thing, but we'll get that in services.
Mm-hmm.
But if they could figure that out, then maybe they got something.
I don't know if they necessarily have to.
Mm.
The 3DS still sells like gangbusters. That's well, I mean,
yeah.
Comparatively, it's doing all right for itself. And I don't, honestly, like you're playing Legend of Zelda in your hand, Breath of the Wild. I think that in and of itself differentiates it from the 3DS.
Yes.
Plus,
oh my gosh.
Really, when you look at both sides, the 3DS has a very nice launch, very nice lineup of games. Available to it, and I think that Switch is going to have its own thing. I know they've already said that this is a home console first. That other thing will be separate, but I'm curious to know more about hardware and what the specs are of this device to see if it will compete. But everything that I've heard and seen so far is promising. So far,
all right. So. I'm going to reference that patent that was found long before any of this was announced or they were talking about the NX. Nintendo owns a patent for essentially a game device that hooks into a dock and runs to your TV. There is obviously the removable aspect. We know all that. It has its own CPU, GPU, all of that. The dock also has a GPU according to the patent, at least from what I can remember. And they also cloud share graphics processing amongst other Switches.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting.
So they may not need the most powerful thing out there to be able to run a 1080p game.
Yeah, but you saw Mario Kart, right? Like, Mario Kart's running on Wii U, and Mario Kart looks better than most, like, okay, some Xbox One games, Mario Kart looks better than.
Well, Mario Kart's 1080p, 60 frames on the Wii U, yeah. So.
Right, right. Yeah. I mean, you don't need a whole bunch of graphical horsepower, though, to make a beautiful-looking game.
No, as Iwata proved, you just have to have good coders.
Right,
yeah, you know. That's... That's a big part. I will say, from what I have seen so far, this is, in my opinion, one of the smartest moves Nintendo has ever made. Nintendo is a leader. They basically, not only a leader, but the creator of the mobile gaming space. Like, taking, and I'm not talking about like Farmville on your phone. I'm talking about taking games on the go. Like, the Game Boy was the Pioneer, thing that mainstreamed that, right? And Pokemon was that killer app that made people buy that.
The Pokemon so and Marios, yeah.
What they have done is they have taken, because I do think that the Switch is a mobile device at heart. Like, it is all about taking it with you. And that's why it's like you have the tablet and then it snaps into this dock, right? And then it becomes a home console. I do think the graphics processing is being done for, you know, for 1080p, 60, whatever benchmarks you want. I do think that's being done in that dock. And I think that when you look at the card, you know, they're card-based now. Mm-hmm. Like, all the games are card-based. So I feel like we're, on the tablet, going to be expecting, like, 720p, but smooth gameplay. But it's not going to be, like, blow your socks off 4K, anything like that. But when you dock it in, that base station, my theory is that it is going to reach out via the web, like you said, with a cloud, whether it's through some kind of peer-to-peer or downloading of a patch per se that enables that to be as beautiful as it is on a screen, right? And if you do that, then at that point you open up the ability to fix graphical issues with the console version after the fact, right? But you still get the luxury of shipping a cart, that, and I say cart as cartridge, that you snap into the thing,
right?
I'm curious to see if you are going to have to do that dock thing. I feel like if it were me, I would sell the tablet thing for $299.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I would sell that for. And maybe have a bundle that's $50 more that comes with Breath of the Wild. Then for maybe $100 to $150 more, I'm not sure, have that dock thing, right? Mm-hmm. That you can get bundled with it. But if I just want a mobile game, like a mobile platform for this, I hope that they let you just do that without having to get the dock. But we're not.
They will not.
They're not going to let you.
Articles I've already read, Polygon's broken a lot of stuff. Nintendo has stated and confirmed this will be a home console first. That is their priority.
Okay.
That is what they're pushing this for. The dock is designed as its charger.
So when you take it on the go,
you're not going to have a separate cable to hook it up. That dock is your charger.
Be carrying the dock a lot.
Mm-hmm. One of the questions I have, I'm sure everybody has, is how long that battery life is going to be on that tablet.
Mm-hmm. I'm calling it. It's 3 hours.
A lot of people have said three. There have been no specific details on that, but those have been confirmed by Nintendo so far. Is mm-hmm. that home console first? The dock is used to charge the tablet.
And that's when you think about the way how you described it, where there's some sort of graphics processing happening in the dock there, if the dock was sold separately, then me as a developer, like, I wouldn't be able to then program for the... I would be developing for tablet only.
It causes fragmentation.
Right, it causes problems.
To some extent.
So,
sorry. As I was going to pick up my phone. Sorry, guys.
One of the things that could be, if you're going along with the bundle lines, it could be the bundle with the dock and the Joy-Cons, and then there's a bundle with the Pro Controller.
Okay, right? Yeah, that makes sense.
The other thing, though, that there was part of the trailer that also was inspirational to me, was the part where you can slide the tablet into sort of like a car seat type thing. But I'm like, why don't we just extend this and say slide a tablet into something like a headset, maybe? Like, what if that screen could be a part of like some sort of VR headset?
I'm telling you, the Switch is actually, it's kind of, you're going to open that box, it's just going to be a VR headset.
You're opening a box that needs to be closed.
Chaz? No. Bad Chaz.
I will tell you, as far as Bundaroos go, I had a deep conversation with my little brother on this in the car the other night. I promise you, I could a Cameron bet on Rocket Punch there will be two bundles. I feel like this console will be $399 at launch, $349 at launch, and then $399 will be the Legend of Zelda bundle. Yeah. That's
You're right. No one's arguing with you.
There will be a Legend of Zelda bundle. There. We all just need to accept that.
If it is half as cool as that Wind Waker Wii U bundle was, with all of the etching on the Wii U Pro Controller or the Wii U gamepad, where do we put all this money? Where will we put it on?
And I think that
it comes with a Zelda amiibo.
It does support amiibo.
It does support amiibo. I just forgot
that amiibo was even a thing.
Yeah, it's still here.
Again, no. I'm going to reference what we referenced a couple weeks back. This whole
comes
thing
out in December.
This everything ends with Mario sitting on a throne of bones. Like, this is the first play. This is the first play. This is the invitation to the wedding that has gone out to everyone.
But they already have their killer app. They proved it by showing only that game at E3 and literally had the longest lines for a booth since the Wii was revealed and announced.
And just imagine that whole game is on a cartridge. That entire game.
Actually, I think that's cool, and I think that's awesome, and I think that is okay by today's standards. Because you think of a game cartridge, we have SSDs that are little micro SD cards that are 64, 128, 200 gigabytes, which is way more than Call of Duty needs on a Blu-ray.
Yeah.
So that's going to be easy.
Are you telling me that Scorpio is going to be a cartridge based platform?
It better be.
I hope it is, just for lols.
There's
no, it'll be Blu-ray, like dual layer Blu-rays. Yeah,
bring back the floppy.
It's got to have that 4K Blu-ray player. So
that's it. You're right.
Yeah.
So what do you think? So we've got, essentially, if you've watched the video, you know, it's you snap these controller bits in and you take the tablet out, but then you can also kickstand the tablet out and disconnect those
and
to
use
them
wirelessly.
As kind of a dual, like, basically like a controller that's like in two pieces, which I think is kind of cool because I could like have my hands like down to my side and still be playing a game.
Like the Wii, minus the motion control.
Yeah, it's a lot, yeah, like the Wii minus the motion control without that weird cable dangly. Yeah. But what's even weirder, and this is my favorite one, is I can be like, hey, Will, you want to play Mario Kart? Here's one of them, and then you get to play on the Game Boy Micro.
No, that's where they lost me. I was like,
what do you mean, dude? That's awesome.
I see Zoolander like looking at that. He's like, what is this? This is a controller for ants. It's like the little Battlefield 1 tiny gun. Like,
I'm curious how big those controllers are going to be for like a lot of guys like us.
I have big hands.
With big hands. It's going to be a little hard to control those.
Those of us that enjoyed the Duke in the past.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Enjoyed the Duke. That's a stretch.
They're going to be this big. I'm grabbing my Wii U to show you. They're going to be that big.
And that's actually not bad. But again, like what I talked about, very much, I'll keep going back to it. I feel like they look at the Wii, they look at the Wii U, they found out what worked. If you remember the Wii U, when you played Mario Kart, you tilted the controller sideways, mm-hmm. and you used the buttons that way. You could do a lot of games that way. Kind of doing that and working around the integration of putting those controllers on the sides, a la Wii U tablet. I'm curious how long they've been working on this.
Since Iwata. I mean, it's been...
No, not since Iwata. Well, before. I mean,
well, it's been a while.
A long time. If I were to guess, it would be since their first earnings report after the Wii U launch.
You think?
Yes. I believe after they saw the lackluster launch of the console, like... Because I don't know if you remember that, but they had, like, this... their estimations were, like, tens of millions of shipments, and they hit 10 million, like... 4 years into the cut. They suspected to sell millions of those, mm-hmm. and they didn't. And because they used the Wii as a chart for that, right? And the
I don't even think they're above 15 million now.
Yeah, it's like, years. So it was like, I'm sure that as soon as that happened, there was a conversation about like, okay, what do we do with this?
Right.
What are we gonna...
Yeah, well, even more so than that, they probably had an R&D team working on it. It may have more so been, okay, work faster. Mm-hmm. Go faster.
Yeah,
We saw evidence of that when they merged the EAD and then the when they merged the departments. When they said, "All right, handheld and console, you are now one department now."
Yeah.
So figure it out.
Yeah.
I think that this is a very Nintendo thing. It's It is something that is built for a little bit for everyone, and I think that other companies, when they try and do this, they don't do a great job of pulling it off, but. Nintendo has their software to back them up, which we'll get to in a little bit, but the idea of like, well, if I don't want to play games like with like on the couch with a friend, I don't have to. Like I can play here. I'm sure that there will be online modes and all of that for everything. But if I do want to go out and I have my tablet with me, I could set it up. I could hand you a controller. My friend could bring theirs as well, and we could be a four-player Smash, you know?
Let's not kid ourselves. This is the console that people buy when they're playing on the living room TV and the wife wants to watch Desperate Housewives or whatever the hell they watch now, and then you have to go to the bathroom. So you take it apart and you walk into the bathroom.
Engage shitter mode.
And you don't have to worry about the wireless signal to your console.
No, see the thing is, this is how my wife and I, we're getting two. You know, one for her, one for me. And we thought we were just going to get like one dock so that, you know, when I want to use a television to play Breath of the Wild, I just... lock it in there, and then I go play. Or when she wants to go and play Animal Crossing or whatever, she just locks hers in there. And then when she goes, oh, I want to use a TV now, I go, okay, uncheck, and then just take it to wherever. Or if you want to play a two-player game, one of the things I like about Smash Brothers is that I, on the Wii U game tablet, I have my own screen. I have, like, visual issues, so I can't mm-hmm. actually see, like, what's going on the screen there. So having my own private screen to view something was amazing. So, yeah, no, it's to Cameron's point, you know, if someone else wants to use a television, totally cool.
Too bad it's Zelda time.
That's why we got the DVR. You get out, it's time for Zelda.
That's why we got the DVR. You can watch that later.
Yeah. So, guys, I looked it up just to be safe. 13.3 million units sold.
Yeah. They haven't hit 15 million. And this console came out in 2012.
Yep.
Before the PlayStation 4 and the Xbox One. So
the PS4 is at 43.4. The Xbox is 22.3.
Yeah.
And then, of course, 3DS, 59.3 million.
May God bless Jack Tritton.
Wherever he is.
I personally can't wait to get my hands on one of these. Like, I'm personally, I remember the Wii U was an internal debate. Because what, and I'll say what it was Wind Waker. Wind Waker, like, that pulled the heartstring for me in the right way. And specifically the words, we've created a new faster sail that requires no wind direction. I was like, sold! Sold! I can play Wind Waker as a video game and not as a do-do-do-do to redirect the wind every 5 seconds. So that was, but for this console, we're going to probably dive into software here in just a moment, but like, just looking at some of the things that Nintendo has planned, it's very exciting. Also, this is my moment, okay? I'm going to say this. Nintendo fixed the single biggest problem that they have always had with the Wii and Wii U. And it is that they didn't have the word Nintendo in the name of the console. So by naming this, this is from the very beginning, from the moment the Wii U came out, I said, man, that was really dumb. They didn't name it something different and name it Nintendo. I've always thought that, like, the idea of, like, because think about your parents, right? Like, your parents, they would get mad at me and they're like, I'm playing PlayStation 2, right? They're like, you better get off that Nintendo. Like, that's just like what they did. And that's that brand association that has been made to video games, right? Like, if it's plugged into a television playing a video game, it started with Nintendo. Mm-hmm. And so for me, when the Wii U came out, I was like, why don't you just like rebrand this and name this like the Nintendo, just call it the Nintendo or whatever you want to, like Nintendo Home, Nintendo Game Platform, whatever you need to call it, but make sure that that brand association is there. So as soon as I saw the word Nintendo Switch, I was like, cool, good. You learned from your mistakes. That's good. You also found out that is a very powerful word in the world. So
aesthetically, it looks damn good.
It looks nice. It looks very nice.
The logo was a masterful stroke because it's like a yin yang logo, but at the same time shows the controllers and just like
it reaffirmed the fact that I knew my brain thinks along the same lines, because when I saw it, I was like, that kind of looks like a yin yang, and then everyone was like, it looks like a yin yang. This is so Eastern. This is Eastern philosophical. I was like, okay, my brain's in the right place. I'm getting there. That's good. Any other things about the hardware? I mean, it's got a great name.
I don't know about the names for the Joy-Con.
Joy-Con.
Joystick controller.
It wouldn't be Nintendo wasn't at least one piece of trash, and that's it.
It's that. Cool that they're going to have a pro controller, so that when you're at home, you don't have to worry about necessarily playing with the
Joy-Con.
Yeah, the Joy-Cons, yeah.
I really think they should just branch that out and make it pair with any other Bluetooth controller you have. Like, I want to play... I mean, it's essentially now an Xbox One controller. I just want to go ahead and just get one of those custom Xbox One controllers and make like the custom NES colors and then just pair it with the...
Well, by that standing, you would also have to say that every console should pair with every Bluetooth wireless controller, which in turn would kill their respective parties' controller support.
Yeah.
Because people would just buy what they
want. If you want the custom controllers, don't worry. This holiday, we've got the Mario controller, we got the Luigi controller, and the Yoshi controller.
God, they can sell them separately.
Yep.
Chez, I mean, come on, dude.
Game accessories make up a large market, so I don't see them going anywhere.
And there was that picture of Instagram that you posted where...
Where some random Photoshop dude just literally went in and just changed the color palettes on all of them.
Now, I'm sure there will be someone that does that. You can like send them your thing and pay them $75 and
they could 3D print them and paint just them or put something. The new plates on them.
Or a better idea, just get a vinyl skin, slap that on there, done.
Yes! This video is sponsored by Skins with a Z.
Oh, jeez. Come on, dude.
It's not. Weird. I don't even think that's a real brand. If not, get on.
Something Skins. It's not Skins exactly, but it's like JK Skins. I don't know.
That's it. JK Skins. I want that Zelda Bundaroo. I want it to have... Because... This is the worst part. Please remember that Breath of the Wild, Link has a tablet. Straight up. He's like, let me pull out my iPad here. Oh, I'm in Hyrule. Okay, good. Like, so I can't wait to see like if they do like a bundle that looks... Because it's like that...
Oh.
It's that like... It's got that stone, but yeah, like Tron laser thing going on. And if they did that, I'd be like, it's $7.99. Here you go. Where is it?
Where do I put the $1,000?
Can I apply for a line of credit?
At GameStop, you can.
Yeah, that's it.
No. I'll just put the MX down.
Oh, watch it be a GameStop exclusive, though.
No.
That won't happen. Nintendo doesn't like doing that kind of crap.
No, they wouldn't do that. The
Xenoblades is high.
So, okay, so before we move on past hardware, there's one more key piece of hardware that we touched on for a very brief amount of time, mm-hmm. but haven't touched on since. Amiibo.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
How does Amiibo play into all of this?
It's going to do the same stuff it's always done.
You tap them and,
mm-hmm. yep.
and get no, stuff?
There's going to be an NFC spot just like there is on your little Wii U tablet.
This
is where the magic happens.
I don't think not on the tablet, but on the Joy-Con control. There's on the Joy-Con controllers where the center there. I think that's where the Amiibo stand is.
Yep.
Like that would be the only place it makes sense.
See, I want on the back of the controller just to like lock in, like magnetically attach the Amiibo. So I'm like walking around with like Princess Peach and Mario like hanging off the back of it. And as long as they're plugged in,
get your Wolf Link just hanging off the back of it. You'd be like,
No, they're it's going to be the exact same thing it is now. You tap it, you'll get a couple of extra level, extra mode.
You don't think they'll do like more significant?
I think Amiibo is going to be for the home. Like, it's going to be when you tap it here, that's when you get the extra stuff and you have it docked and all that stuff. Plus, I don't think it's going to be like I'm taking out my Waluigi and then we're going to just tap it on here and it's going to be
Yes! I want you all to know when the Waluigi Amiibo comes out, we're going to put it right here. It's going to be at the front of every podcast. I think the hardware is exciting. But let's be real here. The thing is going to sell based on software.
Mm-hmm. Oh, don't you worry. They've already fixed that. It's called Breath of the Wild.
So Breath of the Wild we knew was coming to this. It's also coming to Wii U. Yeah. So like it's not exclusive to that platform.
I mean, they did that with the Wii and Twilight Princess to the GameCube. But guess what? It sold on.
I don't want to compare it to that because, quite honestly, the GameCube version
was superior.
The GameCube version is what is heralded as like, wow, that was a way better version. We should have bought that one. But people were wanting to try the Wii one out to kind of see.
Yep.
So like, I think the best way to play it will probably be on the NX. I'm pretty sure, especially based on the video. But
that's the only one we're gonna play it on because honestly. Why would three of us buy it and then what? There's some kind of random multiplayer thing in there and all of a sudden we can't play with Cam?
But here's the thing though. In Breath of the Wild on Wii U, they show the gyroscope controls for like aiming things. Is there a gyroscope in?
There would have to be.
In there?
In the Wii U?
In the Switch?
Yeah, there would have to be. Gyroscopes are like this big now on a circuit board. That's not a non-issue. They're
not hard to put in.
I don't expect the Switch to do anything less than what the Wii U does. Like,
I just hope it's a lot faster on the interface.
Yeah. Oh man, please. Of everything, I hope that Nintendo does something
new,
Wii U-esque, because I love the Wii U interface. Like,
I just want it to be faster.
Faster is good. The Mi Plaza is so amazing. It is one of the best video game splash screens
ever. I like logging in and just seeing the random pieces of art from people.
Yes, you log in, there's this Mario and Sonic at the Olympic Games fan art, which is great because it's mostly Sonic fan art. That's great. And then like one of my... and then you see like, it's just, to me it's like the... People get on the stage at E3 and they're like, community, play with your friends. And they have these like staged, like, yeah, I'm going to go to B, you know, like this stage. But there's nothing quite like logging in and just seeing the sea of like avatars with stupid internet garbage all over the place. And you're just like, this is...
Actually, I logged in earlier today on my Wii U because I just fixed the tablet and fired it up. And right next to the YouTube icon, someone drew, what's her name from Evangelion?
Ray?
No, not any of the girls that actually pilot them. The older like person taking care of them.
Oh, yeah, I know who you're talking about, but the name escaped.
I can't remember her name, but like she was literally just drawn and like hanging out next to the YouTube logo up there. It's like,
that's it.
What?
you're right about that. Okay, so that's getting more into service, services, software. Okay. As far as software, we're talking specifically first about games.
Mm-hmm.
So we have a couple of games that were listed in the video. Specifically, I'm going to read through them here. So we have Legend of Zelda, Breath of the Wild, Elder Scrolls 5, Skyrim.
It looks like it was the HD remaster.
The remaster of that. Mm-hmm. We'll talk about all these. Mario Kart. Some Mario Kart because that was King Boo driving.
Right, it's a different Mario Kart.
NBA Kart game. Switch. Some kind of NBA game. New 3D Mario!
I don't know.
And Splatoon. Each of these create their own little enigma that I want them to solve and answer, because we have third-party games, we have games that have previously been released on Wii U, but they're not sure if these are the Wii U versions or not. Like,
Splatoon. No, these are going to probably be like new ones.
They're going to be new versions.
Yeah, I don't expect any. Bah, all these games, bah, just throw them out. They're probably worth pennies now.
No, man. Well, you don't touch my Wind Waker. You show up.
Yeah, what's probably going to happen is that the Wii U is going to depreciate in value, and then that's when people will go like, oh, $100, sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that could be it. So let's talk about these games. Breath of the Wild, we've been talking about a little bit. Do we think that this is going to... Do you think that the Switch is going to be a big influencer of like how you play the Breath of the Wild? Or is the Nintendo going to step away from the gimmick of the console playing into the game? Like, for me, Skyward Sword was miserable to play. Absolutely miserable to play. Mm-hmm. Because that was a showcase. Like, that was their showcase for Wii Motion Plus, right? Like, the accuracy of the thing. And, like, to me, that was where, like, it got in the way. It's like, oh, you have to chop this way to chop this person. And I was like, this is... No, I just want to hit. This is the hit button. And so, like, for me, that got in the way of it. Do you think they're going to take this and they're going to lean into it as far as, like, oh, for this next boss, you have to disconnect the controllers from the thing?
I don't
think
they're going to do anything like that. No. I think they may have learned from that Skyward Sword. I
think so.
Because the thing is, they can't do that based on the Wii U, right? Everything in the Wii U version has to be in the Switch version.
Okay.
Like, you can't separate the controllers out on the Wii U.
Well, and so they just changed that boss fight mechanic.
Right. Or they say, hey, go get a nunchuck and a Wiimote.
I don't think they do. Not that. Oh, man.
No, I guarantee you they would do that.
Hey, but it's just like Nintendo's always done a great job. Even we were streaming recently Super Mario World, right?
Yeah.
And it was like I blew into the Wii... What is it, the Wii U remote? Or it's the Wii U gamepad. Sorry, I have to remember my on-brand marketing terms here. You blow into it to, like, you know, create a gust of wind. And that's, I think that's a really cool interaction. The chop from the top right to the bottom left to kill this type of enemy, or godforsaken bomb rolling. Did y'all ever play Skyward Sword?
Yeah.
Bomb rolling?
It was great.
Skyward Sword. I died more times than I actually succeeded bomb rolling. I could not bomb roll. I couldn't do it to save my life. But, like, rather than those types of experience... Like, do you think that this is going to be something, or is this mainly just a how you choose how you play type of game?
No,
I'm hoping it is purely. I can grab my pro controller, sit down at like midnight with no lights on, throw just some Turtle Beaches or whatever on, and just sit back and be like, I'm killing this now.
The main part of the Nintendo Switch is the aspect of changing from a home console to a portable machine. That is their I don't want to say gimmick, but that is their hook. Per se, in this time, you think about the Wii and the Wii U. The Wii had the motion controllers, and the Wii U kind of had the gamepad as their hooks. Nintendo is smart enough to know they do not need to add another hook or gimmick into the console with a particular game. When people like, with the fact alone of saying that, remember that huge game that you played at E3 and that you saw these videos for, and it's open world and it's Legend of Zelda and it's all this craziness. Now you can take it on the go.
Oh my god!
Yes. Mic drop, walk away. That's all you need to do. And I think that's
what they've been doing for the past year. They said we brought Pokemon to phones.
Oh my god! Yes.
And I think that's all that they are going to do, because they really, you don't need another gimmick. The fact of, like, when you want to, you can play this awesome Zelda game that you're already liking and take it with you on the go. Yeah. That's going to be sold. Enough for.
Yeah, I think when it comes to Nintendo, they have the strongest software lineup of any game company in the world. I think that if Sony, if Microsoft, if anybody had gone through the period that they had gone through recently with the Wii U, that it could have detrimentally harmed their long-term strategy, if not put the company, you know, like... Microsoft had to work to come back from that Xbox One, right? Sony had to work to come back from the PlayStation 3.
Mm-hmm.
And Nintendo's really just, like, they kind of gritted their teeth and got through it, but now they're just like, well, Pokemon are on phones now, and then you can take the Zelda with you.
Don't kid yourself. They had to work to get out of that.
To not have to fire
that
people.
Wii U.
Like, all the executives had to take, like, a 40-something percent pay cut.
Yeah,
like,
no, that's true, yeah.
I mean,
bottom line stuff.
Like, the difference is that the company has money.
The company has a lot of cash.
Like, yeah. Sony and Microsoft. Microsoft has more money than Sony, but, like, they don't have, like, oh, we can watch this. Just throw money at it.
Well, and I think a lot of that's because we've always, like, even the Wii U, right? Like, the Wii U wasn't heralded as a great console. But in retrospect, you and I talk about it all the time. Well, like, the games lineup, like, if you were to buy a Wii U today, you've got options. Like, great options. Super Mario Maker, Super Mario 3D World, if you're a Mario fan, the two Legend of Zelda remakes, the
Splatoon.
Mario Smash Kart. Brothers, Mario Kart, like, great games available. It just took 5 years to roll those all out, and now the console's cheaper than it was when there were none of those games. So when you look at those software titles, you know, we haven't even talked about, like, you've got your Kirby's that have come out, Yoshi, like, just Metroid.
Calm down, it's okay.
I didn't mean to. I didn't mean to reopen that wound. But they own that lot, right?
But hang on, because they brought some of the old Metroid games to the Wii U via the digital downloads.
Yeah. There's a lot that they have in their pocket. And so looking through this list, now Breath of the Wild is going to generate some serious cash for them.
And remember, Nintendo doesn't sell at a loss.
They don't. New Super Mario, the new 3D Mario game. Yeah. Yeah.
See, now, that's it. There's been some speculation on the internet based on the pictures that they've seen of the new Mario game that there was some, like, Samba de Amigo stuff in there, also some Sonic stuff in there. What if this new Mario game is like a Mario Sonic crossover?
Does that mean I can go fast while getting mushroom power-ups? Because if that's the case, I'm okay with it.
There's not a lot of things. There's not a lot of things on this earth that would make me just disappear. But if the next 3D Mario game is a Sonic crossover, you'll come over to the record in this home right here, in my home, and there will be a letter that says, "I tried but failed. Goodbye." I don't know where I'll end up. I'd become a drifter somewhere. Probably end up in some ditch in Reno. But I would not. I would abandon everything that I know and leave this life that I know.
Why?
Because that is... No. No. No.
Yeah,
the minute that Dr. Robotnik meets eyes with Bowser, that entire universe just unravels in my mind. It's done. It is done. Done.
But what if Bowser kills Robotnik? Like, claw through the chest.
Because, yeah, that's how Mario and Sonic do.
That's exactly how it works.
Rated D for everyone, kids.
Being real, I think that would be, first, the most hilarious game ever. Mm-hmm. Because that would be like, I just want to go drop that off in 1994 and just see what happens from that. Just drop a video of that off.
I deliver unto you and your war.
It would just be, it would have to be some kind of Sonic Team collaboration, but I don't. No, Mario was good. Sonic is Sonic.
They wouldn't do that on a brand new Mario game for a new console. That might be something that they would do later. After multiple Mario games have come out, maybe they test something out.
Or the next Olympics rolls around. Hey, surprise.
Yeah, that is where you get that kind of trash. It's built into the Olympics. Now, there's been people that are like, well, that gameplay footage was fake. Surprise, all gameplay footage that you see on TV commercials are fake. So it's like she was holding a blank screen or probably a green piece of fabric over the prototype. Mm-hmm. And then they went and added that back in. But based on the look of that game, that was amazing. That was like... Galaxy was great, and it had that whole, like, round, it had that aesthetic to it, but this looks very much like we went back, we took the Super Mario 64 formula, and we have now made that into a fully fledged full game, right? We're walking on a flat ground, this is flat, there is flat, this is a world that we're walking through, there's no, like, it's not like the toy box that you have with a 3D world or the side scroll only option, like, it is a 3D Mario game. And if they do that with half of the sheen that they did with Super Mario 64 way back in the day, again, where are we going to put all this money? We're going to need to buy another island just to build a money facility to store all the money.
Nah, man, it's all ones and zeros now. Don't worry.
Yeah, that's probably the case. But yeah, then the idea of just taking that with you, like...
Oh, dude.
That's the best part. That's the best part about the Switch. It's like, all this cool shit, now take it with you.
Even better.
Roll out.
I can't wait for some like third-party group to sit down and be like, we've engineered a charging cable for it. Don't worry. because somebody will do it.
It's going to be a backpack with the cable that comes out, you know, and it's going to be 3 days worth of battery in the backpack.
No, you're going to see people walking around Big Spring Park with the Switch and just mm-hmm. big old backpack going.
Mm-hmm. Why does it have to be a big backpack? It'd just be a fanny pack. Just have it like yep. right there.
Oh, because welcome back to the 90s.
Welcome to the 90s. There we go.
I mean, Nintendo probably wants the 90s back.
Solar panels.
What if they put solar panels in the Joy-Cons, then...
no, that's nowhere near enough.
We are off the rails.
Yeah.
We have taken the rails, and we have melted them down into bullets that we are now firing into the air.
Correction, we melted them into bullet bills.
Is Bullet Bill made of metal?
I would assume so if he's a bullet.
It's very hard to engineer, like, pure black metal.
So like, oxidization.
Okay. Yeah. I don't know much about manufacturing, so.
Make it difficult.
Nope, the train just crashed. Well, everybody just keep walking.
So here's I really think this was like the weird proverbial bomb drop of that video, Skyrim.
Right.
Yeah.
Skyrim is big, like huge, and the fact that they are showing that as a playable game on the Switch is a statement as to like, hey, there are going to be cool third-party games. Now, they also fooled me once. I remember them on stage. They're like, we've got Arkham City. We've got Mass Effect 3. There were Wii U versions of all those games.
Yep, they were.
They were not good.
I like Mass Effect 3 for the Wii U. I just didn't want to play through all
of it. You just didn't want to buy it again and play the exact same game on the other console. Oh. That's the thing. So, like, they're doing kind of the same thing here. But of everyone, like, Skyrim was one of those games where there was always something weird on every...
Infinite
like,
replayability.
If anyone remembers the original Kinect, Fusroda, if you remember that. Like, that was a fantastic gimmick for that console. And now they've got the remastered edition, so I wonder if there's going to be some type of thing. Or if they're just going to port it. It may just be a port.
The thing about Skyrim that makes me incredibly ecstatic about that is that if it is the remastered version, from what all the reports that everyone was talking about, that engine was used to make Fallout. If you're able to put Skyrim Remastered on there, you can put Fallout on there. If you can put Fallout on there...
It could be a game console.
It could be a game console, right? You're sitting there going like, wait, if they could put Fallout on there, what's to stop them from doing like the next Batman game or...
Money.
Okay, well, yeah. Besides money.
That was the issue with the Wii and the Wii U is that the player base was... They bought it to play Wii Sports, and then they're not going to buy any other games, so people stopped making games for it because were just selling better.
But then you can put the new Call of Duty on there. You can put Doom on there.
But are you going to play Call of Duty on the Wii, on the Nintendo Switch?
Dude, I take my Switch to work, and we say, let's all gather around and play Call of Duty. After we're done playing Call of Duty, let's go ahead and play Mario Kart. Let's go ahead and play other things, like Smash Brothers or something.
You want those games there.
Want those games there. I want them to put Destiny on this thing. Like, go ahead, Bungie. Let's do this. Let's put Destiny on Nintendo Switch.
Isn't Activision a partner?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's possible. Yeah. Very much.
Seth is just going to love to be able to play Destiny 2 on the Switch.
No. What if... Oh, wait.
No, you won't because it'll be always online. Just like Destiny is. It's always online.
Actually, yeah.
That's true. No.
Right. So you can only play it at home.
I am 99% certain that Nintendo will have a thing in there that says you cannot make always online games like that. I really do feel like that would be something. Because they're that toy company mentality of like you should be able to buy it and pick it up and put it into your home and never touch the internet but still be able to play it. And the Wii U gets away from that a little bit, but like if you buy Super Mario Maker, you can still play a video game without having to do the online levels, even though the online levels is where that game is at. So I don't know. That's on that specific note. Just
partner with AT&T and go ahead and put a 3G or 4G radio in there.
We don't do 3G nowadays.
It's gotta be LTE. I don't want to add the Nintendo Switch to my cellular data plan. No, thank you. Moving on.
All of a sudden, 10 gigs of data usage. We don't know where it all went.
That goes straight. Okay.
New Mario Kart.
Yeah.
King Boo is playable. Confirmed. Best Mario Kart ever made.
Well, again.
You also have the ability to use two items.
Yeah,
double dash. So the best thing about Mario Kart Double Dash is now in Switch. You are correct. Mm-hmm. Best Mario Kart game ever.
Double Dash 2.
Mm-hmm.
Ooh.
Name it.
Mario Kart Switch.
Yeah, it's going to be all the basic. Super Mario Switch, Mario Kart Switch. Oh,
really?
Switch.
That does sound really good. It does sound really good.
Oh, Mario Kart Switch, though. You can do the Double Dash thing.
Yep.
Imagine if you got the two controllers out and you could do the Switch by like...
I hope they don't put accelerometers in.
Now you're borderlining very close to
no Wii. Monster.
Mm-mm. Wii territory there.
Bring me in. Bring me on board. I'll enhance every game.
Freaking motion controller, stop.
They didn't show much about this. We know it's new because we see the double items, King Boo and all that. We know it's not just a port of Mario 8 or Mario Kart 8. But I would love to. I think a Mario Kart game is really important to showcasing the, you know, that's what they showed the little controllers. You know, I hand you a controller and we're playing Mario Kart. I think they showed that, and then the NBA game. Those were the two that they showed, like, with the separate controllers. Yeah. So that's a really cool idea to be able to, like, play Mario Kart, because that is a great split-screen game.
I just don't think split-screen works well on that small screen. Like, I mean, we haven't seen the exact dimensions of that.
That's why you need to buy your own copy, and we'll just link them up.
There we go. And that's what it needs to be.
And then more licensed sales.
That's it.
Oh, my God.
So speaking of the new NBA game, a new NBA game was shown, which there's not anything specific about this.
The only NBA game I'm ever interested in is NBA Jam.
It'd be great if they brought that back.
So, otherwise, moving on.
They did try.
I mean, I think it's a big deal to say that there's a sport game, like a sport game on it, because those are, whether you like them or not, they are a big part of...
FIFA is the most selling game
ever. Yeah, FIFA, Madden, those are big games in the U.S. And I know that with basketball as well, like basketball, there's 2K series, and then there's the NBA Live, I think is what it's called.
I think it's only the 2K series right now.
Oh, it's only 2K right now?
I haven't heard from NBA Live.
NBA Live hasn't, yeah.
Well, that would be a partnership there to bring that back.
Well, I think that's just showcasing more third-party support.
More third-party support. Well, because remember also, this whole thing is just chock full of marketing trash. And remember, everyone was there playing basketball, and then they're like, oh, let's gather around and play our basketball game here at the basketball court we just played basketball at. So they were like trying to showcase like...
portability and all
like,
that.
Like, oh, it fits with your lifestyle, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know if that will even be a game. Because there are some of these on here, like the Skyrim thing. Todd Howard was like, yeah, that was a great demo. We're still not sure if we're going to be shipping Skyrim on this or not. So well, like... I wonder if they are just showing these as like promotional.
No, it's marketing speak for on his because Skyrim Remastered comes out next week. So if I was a marketing person and someone showed me that on Nintendo's console I'm gonna get Skyrim Remastered, what am I gonna do with my $60? Gonna spend it on Skyrim Remastered on my current system or wait for the Switch? And so they're not gonna confirm or deny that Skyrim Remastered is on Switch until enough Skyrim Remastered have sold next
Okay.
I have a correct answer for Skyrim Remastered. Mm-hmm. If you bought it and all the DLC on PC, you get it for free.
Right. Well, yeah.
That's the correct answer.
Plus, there's no confirmation that game is a launch game.
Right. Yeah.
So, I mean, people are thinking, oh, it's going to come out in March. It may be next summer. Okay, yeah. Well, we think we can do this. We'll fiddle with it. And it's just a way for them to make extra money.
Yeah.
And especially kind of gauge to see how sales go for the Switch.
Thinking about what you said a moment ago, like I think that the killer feature for this is, remember that new Zelda game we showed you? You can take it with you. Like that is the thing. Like it's, you don't need anything else beyond that.
If you could take
Mario Kart and Splatoon and Zelda with you everywhere, what else do you need?
That brings us to the storage, though. How much memory is going to be in this?
It does have an SD card slot.
Oh,
it's not a Nintendo console if there's not an SD card slot. Let's be real.
At least they support a standard, unlike some of the other people.
Yeah.
Yeah, very much.
I mean, nowadays, like with everything basically does USB storage.
Mm-hmm.
And then SDs, you know, I just love Nintendo's like dedication to cartridge garbage. Like, if it's got to look like a cartridge to be considered Nintendo worthy, you know, the USB, no USB sticks or anything like that. But the last game, this one is way bigger than people will think, is Splatoon.
Yeah.
Splatoon raised. So the way they showed Splatoon was a couple of things. One, they did this whole esports thing. where like it was like the teams were training, like we're gonna practice Splatoon, and then we're gonna go on stage and compete for Splatoon, which is again marketing trash. But that makes me wonder: is Nintendo looking at esports?
And if so, Splatoon is going to be one of the ways to go.
Yeah, like they did the World Championship a couple years back, if you remember. They brought that back to showcase Super Mario Maker, and that was like that was a fun throwback. And they really did invent, the video game tournament, you know, with the Nintendo World Champions that they used to do. And to see them bring their competitive game to the forefront as Splatoon, to be the marketer for that, like that's... interesting. Like, is there going to be like a tournament system in this? Is there going to be a leaderboard thing? Are they going to have those competitive features beyond just play the game, have fun?
Well, I mean, I think that was sort of targeted towards people who are interested in esports. I mean, I'm not sure if Nintendo themselves are interested in it, but more so the lines of them talking to Riot Games or them talking to
you keep your MOBAs out of my Nintendo, all
right? Right, they're talking to all these people out there going like, if you want...
Yeah, Seth over here, he's dying.
I'm sorry, but they're trying to make it sort of mainstream. they're trying to tell these other guys, look, if you want to have your like giant arena mobile game stuff, you can do that on the system. And so they would want to court people like, you know, the League of Legends people. They would want to court...
the correct answer is Blizzard.
You know, Blizzard, and say, hey, you could run StarCraft on this maybe. You know, they want to get these people.
No, Overwatch. This is the new Overwatch box.
I think esports is too big for Nintendo not to ignore now.
Yeah.
So I'm not going to be surprised if there's a... if for Splatoon or maybe even Mario Kart or something like that, where they add in like some type of esports functionality or features.
At least a tournament feature where you could like get with 30 other people and race to win, you know?
Yep. They added tournament features to Mario Kart and to Smash Brothers. And the tournament features in Smash Brothers are okay. They're like a start.
Other companies have started that too. I think PlayStation announced this past week some like PlayStation tournaments feature for the software. I think Microsoft has something similar to that.
That was back at the arena.
Yeah, they call it back at E3. So I mean, it's not going to be surprising if Nintendo walks in and adds something to that mix.
I just want on the back of the NX there's a red switch, right? you flip the switch protector up and you flip it. And as soon as you do, there's like this huge overlay that comes on that says, "We esports now, baby." Just like when the Y is going off the screen. And then it just like engages esports mode where it turns off everything that's consuming power. And now we esports, baby. That's what I want.
Oh, Jesus.
But on top of that, so here's the other side of that. So they showed Splatoon, a Wii U game, on the Nintendo Switch.
Right.
That implies one of two things. One, it implies there will be a sequel to Splatoon, which is the more likely option, like Splatoon 2. It's
been
a while
since Splatoon's been out. So
it's like that. They're just, hey, there's a new Splatoon for the Nintendo Switch. But that also raises the question of, will there be any backwards compatibility, not on the disc side, but on the like downloadable side of the Wii U?
I think if there is, that's the way to go. I think that's the easier route for Nintendo, especially with them, when you think about the creation of My Nintendo and the basically all the Nintendo Rewards stuff that they shut down and they kind of brought back up for the 3DS. Everything's unified into one thing. And so you log in with your My Nintendo ID and you have access to all your games if they're playable on Switch.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's... if that's going to happen, it's going to be... like, if you bought this game digitally, guess what?
I would love to be able to just turn my Switch on, sign in with my Nintendo account, and all of a sudden my 3DS games and my Wii U games show up.
Yep.
That's the dream, isn't it, Will? That's the dream.
Or what if they did something special with your 3DS and they say, hey, you know that 3DS now that you have? Just take that memory card out, or the SD card out of your 3DS and put it in your Switch. No.
They won't do that.
No. Nintendo would never do that.
Well, they won't do that because it's
$299 a piece to
convert. The new 3DS XL is not user-friendly to remove. You do have to take the back cover off, and then It's sitting right there inside of the device. So
are you talking about the SD card?
Yeah, I mean, I changed mine out to a 64 gig in like 2 seconds. Now, but
it does have IR, so like I imagine anything like that could probably be like wirelessly done. But again, why give it to you for free when we could sell it to you?
Yeah.
So and I'm just wondering, are they going to try and port those games over, or are they just going to be like, this is the Normally, I would think they're just going to do a sequel, right? They're going to do Splatoon 2. It will come out on the Switch. They will do Mario Maker 2 or whatever like that. They wouldn't try and port them. But then there's Smash Brothers, which Smash Brothers has done really well.
And Sakurai has come out and said he's not doing another Smash.
And I don't think he has it in him to do another good one. So, like, that's the one where if they do anything, they would have to port it and re-release it as a, like, Super Smash Brothers Switch. Yeah, that's what it would have to be. But I really do think it would be smart because they've always done backwards compatibility. Every console that Nintendo's released since the... Really, I think the GameCube was the only one that wasn't back compat with their previous, like...
Yeah, because
basically since the Wii, it's always been back compatible.
But yeah, because the Wii did the GameCube, and the Wii U did the Wii.
Well, the Wii U's back compatible to some extent. I don't think it's the full library, but I think you can play some games
on it. You can play Wii games.
Okay.
Yeah, you just put the Wii disc in and it goes
into
Wii mode.
The requirement is you have to have like the sensor bar and a Wiimote. So the gamepad really has no
functional
use beyond just being a TV screen.
The only way they could do that is if they added an optical drive to the dock.
And it would be like... Or there was some kind of... you know those Nintendo network codes they used to include in all the games?
Yeah.
You register that to your account, you download it.
Yeah.
Or if you have a Wii U, you just take a USB cable from your Wii U to the Switch dock, and then it just goes, oh, you put in your... It just acts as a gamepad. Like, your Switch then acts as a gamepad for the Wii U.
But at that point, why don't you just turn the Wii U on?
That's true.
This is for people who want to get rid of the old console and still keep all the games.
Yeah.
Yep.
But I think to your point, you're correct that Nintendo's already tried this before. Like when you switch from the Wii U from the Wii, that if you downloaded like the virtual console games, they sold them back to you like at a reduced price.
Yeah, like $2 or $3, something like that. Because here's, like, let's be real. The 13 million people that own Wii U's are your super fans. These are the Nintendo fans. These are the people who buy whatever you release. And so to create something that kind of slaps them in the face, you probably be okay. I'm pretty sure that most of us could be like, psh, like Mario could slap us. We'd still be like, when's the next one coming out? Like as we cry, we would fight the tears. But like it would be nice to have some kind of, if you remember the 3DS early adopter program.
Oh yeah,
that thing when it was like when it first came out was like $350.
Oh yeah, and you got like 6 free games.
You got like a bunch of free games. You got like special badges and things like that, which are now totally frivolous because none of that carries over. But if there was some kind of like exclusive
ambassador program
thing, I don't know.
Well, so if you got the Wii U 32 gigabyte, there was like a thing that you signed up for that whenever you purchased games, you took surveys or something like that, you got some money back to purchase towards. Other Wii U games.
Oh yeah, the pro version,
like the pro or whatever. If you were still signed up for that, maybe that's a way for them to detect that you got a Wii U in the games that you purchased, and then it'll allow you to.
Yeah, but then that still screws anybody who bought the white Wii U.
I think that anything network wise that existed in Nintendo servers was wiped when the reward program was deleted. I think they really were like,
yeah,
that was the reset button for them.
That's a great segue into
services. Yes, it is a beautiful segue. It's almost like it was orchestrated somewhat. Services. This is, I would say, Nintendo's biggest area of opportunity across the board. Like you said, Will, that's the dream.
Yep.
That's the dream is I buy Mario one time and it's mine on all the Nintendo things. And they've provided a platform that provides both portable and home console use. But what do we want from the Nintendo Network, which is, I think it is called like the Nintendo Network.
Yeah, because you have your Nintendo Network ID whenever you load it up on the DS or on the Wii U. Honestly, I would like to be able to sign in and be like, oh, hey, you've got all these games that you bought on your Wii U and your 3DS, as far as like virtual console titles, and just download them all.
Unified Network ID. Unified.
That's already there.
I have a 3DS. I'm talking about like...
No, it's there. It's called the Nintendo Network.
I know that, but just showing that for the Switch, unified across the board, none of the whatever stuff they were doing before, and they've already taken steps to do that.
Yep.
But I want to see that implemented when the Switch comes out. I'm just like, I can sign in. A much easier interface of just I sign in and I can see, okay, these are the 3DS games that I've registered and own on my 3DS, and here are my other games here.
If I go, like, if let's say for example you pull your Switch out and we set it up here and I want to play Mario Kart with you, right? I would like to be able to tie that to my account, that progress that I make, those high scores and all of that, go back over to my game if there's internet involved.
Here's what you do. You take a hard look at Xbox Live, you copy that, and then you take the benefits of the PlayStation Store where you can cross-buy, cross-save.
Mm-hmm. So you say
buy that, marry them together, and get the new Nintendo Network.
You say take Xbox Live and this, save, put them together, then save as .switch.
Yes. Export as... Yeah. SWTH.
No. So, export as .Nintendo.
So now, for the purposes of full disclosure, or for the purposes of clarification, Microsoft with the Xbox Play Anywhere program does support cross-buy, cross-save. So the correct way to say that is if you would just copy Microsoft.
Right, but I'm talking about like Nintendo or Sony's approach whenever you buy a game, like say on the Vita, you get the PS4 version or the PS3 version, and vice versa. It really needs to be that way moving forward.
Well, there's only one version. It's the Switch version.
Well, they said the 3DS is still going to be something that they support.
Yeah. See, what I really need to stress here about their online services is that their network needs to work. Right? Because, yeah. I mean, I know it goes without saying, you know, that you have an online network that you connect, but just the ability of connecting with millions of people and having them all go on this different servers and then having all of them connecting with each other is taken for granted. It needs to work. I need to load up the Switch, get into a game of Splatoon, find people easily, and play the game. If I have to sit there on my Switch and I'm sitting there like on the bus or something, or however I'm sitting at work on a break and it's taking me like my whole 15 minutes to just get into a game, nah, brah, it's done. We need to have a working network. Like when the PlayStation Network went down a couple of years ago, that was a sad day. You know, I mean,
you mean
the sad month. Sad month, yeah. You know, because you're sitting there going like, I want reliability of net, and that's one thing that Microsoft has always gotten right with Xbox Live from the very beginning, get go. It was network works. I put in Halo 2, I log into the game, I find a game, I play it and shoot the mans. That's what needs to happen.
Man shooter coming soon to Nintendo Switch. So, only on Nintendo Switch.
Postal 3 going to the Switch.
Yeah, you know, you're right about that. Microsoft gets to cheat because they're, you know, a server infrastructure company.
Right.
The thing, I think that everything that you said is 100% true. What Nintendo's needed to do for a long time is get this shit branded, right? Like, Nintendo Network, this is your ID. When you buy this game under this ID, it is yours. You can play it on your friend's console, you can play it on your console, and your saves sync over, cross-buy, cross-save, whatever you want to call it. That is something that Nintendo has needed for a long time. When you do, I think for the most part on the Wii U, when you go online, it's not that bad. It sometimes can get pretty bad, but like they're getting that down. But I think they've partnered with DNA to just like, you do it for us. Figure it out.
You fix this.
Yeah, like, you do it. We're paying to play here. But that is, when you look at these types of competitive games, especially with the esports stuff that we talked about earlier, like, that has to be there. Because if you drop a single frame in a fighting game,
you're done.
You're done, yeah.
The other thing, though, that I really think they could leverage is their mobile phone and mobile phone and console services. Mm-hmm. Even though this is a console first, right? Having the ability to get notifications in Miitomo or having some crossover between the Fire Emblem for, you know, mobile devices or Animal Crossing for mobile devices to the Switch is going to be vital in terms of cross-branding. So, for instance, if I'm a parent who loves playing Fire Emblem because I grew up with Fire Emblem and everything else, but I've been hesitant to get a Switch, As soon as, you know, my kid goes, hey, look, there's a Switch thing and it has a new Fire Emblem on it, I'm going to be more apt to get Fire Emblem for the Switch because I already have the mobile version, you know, or vice versa. If I have Fire Emblem on the Switch and I have like an Android phone or an iPhone in my pocket, I'm like, yeah, let's go ahead and download that Fire Emblem for my mobile device. Let's go ahead and do that.
They have talked about doing that for the Fire Emblem and Animal Crossing versions of the mobile devices whenever those games come out.
Here, let me pull out my tinfoil right quick. All right. Imagine if your phone's in your pocket, right? You have Miitomo installed and signed in with your Nintendo Network ID.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I sit down in front of Cameron's or Will's or Chaz's Nintendo Switch and I pick up the controller. The controller senses the connection to my phone in my pocket, and I have enabled this in the settings for Miitomo, and it says, hey, Seth, because it connected via Bluetooth. And then I just start playing, and it knows it's me because I am holding the controller with my phone in my pocket.
Oh, my God.
Because Bluetooth can sense location.
And then, yeah, because it's like, okay, so there are four phones near me. They're all signed into Miitomo, but this is the one that I'm closest to. Like, by simply having the phone in my pocket, I am signed into the Nintendo Network. Figure out how that looks as far as technology is concerned, but like, how cool would that be? I could walk up to a demo kiosk, start playing, and they're like, hey, Seth, thanks for playing the demo. Here's an item that you unlock when you get home, right? For playing. Like, you could at that point do all kinds of, like, come visit us at the Nintendo booth and you'll get a item for Animal Crossing or whatever. And like, that would, that is the, when you talk about the, all these articles about like, geolocation and like really kind of some of the stuff Pokemon Go did, right? Like like getting us out there and moving, that is it. That's the dream. That is the culmination of Street Pass into its perfect form. Like, this is my final form. Street Pass but on phones. Done. Like, you want to make sure people have your stuff installed.
Oh my gosh. Yeah, no, because then you could do street.
Exactly.
I would I think.
Hold on, let me take the tinfoil off. That's it.
Going further on that point, I would rather them, instead of leveraging Miitomo, I would like to see a new, just a Nintendo app.
Like a Nintendo like Network.
The Xbox app or the PlayStation app where you could actually go in and shop the Nintendo store instead of having to be on the console.
Yeah.
If a new Nintendo game comes out, I can say, pull up my phone, buy, download now to my Switch. Oh, so that when I get home, Legend of Zelda is ready to play.
Oh, you have, don't have to wait. You have your Switch with you, so the next time you reach Wi-Fi again, it just automatically downloads or whatever.
Well, I'm sure that the dock, look, it's Breath of the Wild.
Okay.
It's going to download to the dock, and then it's going to just link into the
That's going to be 20 to 30 gigabytes, and let's go ahead and download. Now, what would be cool is if the dock, this leans back to hardware, if the dock has an SD card too, and it can download it even when your Switch is not attached, so when you get home, it like you can start playing and then it kind of like it starts moving everything over. Oh man, that's
services is their biggest potential, but with the freedom and flexibility the Switch has to offer, that like the possibilities are endless. And I hope that this isn't the part where like whenever Nintendo announces something new, there's always the period of like bright-eyed, like they could do this, and that's what we're doing right now, right? Putting on tinfoil hats and saying what they could do, and then they actually do it and it's like, you share your 26-digit code online to share your Super Mario Maker Worlds. And you're like, you couldn't come up with a better way than that? Like, that's the best that you could do? So I'm hoping that they are learning and taking some of this to heart because...
Yeah, because then at that point, you could share your Mario Maker stuff to your Nintendo Network ID, and then all of a sudden it's up on their cloud.
It ends with Mario sitting on a throne of bones. And if you... Like, software is solid. Like, toe-to-toe with any other brand on software, I think that you win. I think that if a lot of people were asked to like pick a game console that they could do without, it would have to be like a Nintendo because it's just, there's so many memorable games. Like when you think about the games that we like, no one has as much nostalgia for video games as I think that they do for Nintendo. This is proven by, I logged into Facebook and saw 1 million people talking about the Nintendo Switch, right?
Day one, 10 million views on that video.
Yeah, it's just like phenomenal. And it's like Nintendo has no trouble with software whatsoever. They've had struggles with hardware, you know, like the Wii U delivered on the performance, it just didn't deliver on the...
Well, there was branding issues.
There was branding issues. There were issues with the other pillars, right? And then services is just... They never even tried. Like,
remember Nintendo TV? What happened to that?
It did. They canceled shit.
Yeah, there was a whole announcement from Reggie Fils-Aimé saying bye-bye.
Like, if Nintendo, here's what your video strategy needs to be. Does it run the Netflix app? Check. All right, moving on.
Does it run Netflix? Does it run the Hulus? Does it run the Crunchyrolls? Does it run the Funimation? Yeah. Good.
Mm-hmm. I do agree with you on the Nintendo app. I want them to go bananas on this. Like, we joke about the Nintendo phone. I think the Nintendo phone would actually do really, really well. Like, because imagine if you, like, tap. Each tap is like, ba-ding! Like a coin, like just the nostalgia you would have. But if you could build it into an app, would be.
Oh my god!
No, they don't need if to make I could a phone, they just need to go ahead and put the app on Android and iPhone.
No. You make a Nintendo phone. I drop my iPhone and I go buy the Nintendo.
Well,
phone.
I'm saying that is like imagine if the app had that much charm to it, right?
Oh,
like
right.
It had that
shopping the storefront, checking your rewards.
And being able to video message your other Nintendo friends from it.
Being able to check the hot garbage / beautiful artwork that is the Miiverse.
What you talked about with friend codes and whatnot, like if you have your games in there, like or Super Mario Maker and you have your levels, you can just like peer-to-peer, like airdrop or some other functionality like that, mm-hmm. You send it to their app and then that lets them know, okay, when you access your 3DS or your Switch, it'll automatically download the levels.
I just want to be able to turn my phone sideways and draw Miiverse posts. Please don't kill the Miiverse. I need it to still be alive. It is the best social network out there, period. It is great. It is the best type of internet garbage, all culminated into one. The Splatoon Miiverse never fails to impress.
Well, they just have the Miiverse app on the Switch, and then there you go. And then they put the Miiverse app on your phone. That would be
That would be a page one of the home screen app for me.
That would be the only app I don't have in a folder.
Yeah. It would replace my music app because I go to music to be entertained. I would replace that with that more entertaining app.
No, you keep the music app to play the Nintendo soundtracks while you're opening Miiverse.
That's it.
So speaking of services then,
mm-hmm.
One of the things that both the Xbox One and the PS4 have is remote play, right? So you can stream your system to different devices within the home or even if you know how to do it right, tunnel it to a different location. Do you think Nintendo would offer such kind of remote play?
No, the remote play is you take the tablet with you.
Yep.
Right.
With Seth on that one.
Yeah, it's the Microsoft tried it. They said, "Nah, we're not doing this." The latency is always the issue there. Mm-hmm. Like latency is the issue, and that's why they did the Xbox Play Anywhere. PlayStation does the cross-by-cross save. Nintendo's solution is
just take it with you.
Undock and lock, baby. Let's roll. That's it. The idea of just being able to take Breath of the Wild portable. That's it.
Now, what if they were smart and they bundled it with every system?
What do you mean, though?
Just Breath of the Wild comes with
every... If it was a pack-in, first off, they would have to buy the island to put the money. They would. I don't think they would.
No.
Like, if there's anything that you pack in, it would be, I hate to say this, but, like, the Nintendo Land, like, some kind of metaphorical, like, mini-game exhibition of, like, what this can do. But I think they're over
that. You have to remember, they're a business. So doing that would leave money on the table. Would it be a great, like... pro gamer, pro consumer move, sure, but that's $50 on the table left every time somebody 60, buys
60, $59.99.
Okay, well, yeah. I think that the bundle will happen. It will be $50 more,
and people will buy the bundle.
Especially if it is a different console. Like if it is a cool looking console, there's no question that that will outsell the core base.
Yep.
For launch day sales at least. So that's there. Now, the last thing I want to talk about isn't so much a services thing. It's more of a message thing. When you watch this video, there was something that really stuck out to a lot of people, and it is who... Here's a rule of video, right? Whoever you are watching in a video for a product is the target demographic for that product. That's just the way it goes. It's either the target demographic or what that company thinks the demographic wants to be, right? And it's just, marketing is shitty. It sucks. It's garbage. It's horrible. But that's what it is, right? So in this video, they showed a lot of adults.
Like, oh, they were marketing 20-somethings,
30, yeah, 30-somethings that were playing these games. Not a lot of kids. Most of, like, hanging out with my friends. Not, I am a kid, you know, going to school. Not a, I'm a parent or anything like, it's like, I am hanging out with my friends and I have the Nintendo Switch with me. Message-wise, like, is this a shift for them? My theory on this is that they're just going to come out with a press. They're like, the new Yo-Kai Watch is coming to Switch. There, kids marketing done. Like, that would be, or new Mario or whatever. I think that's going to, that the kids marketing will come in time. But for this initial release, what do you think about them targeting specifically the adult market for now?
I think it's the best move possible because it's the adult who's going to buy it. And then once the adults buy it and the hardcore buys it, then they evangelize out to everyone else. Like, there was a teenager who came into work one day who was just with their mom and everything else. They were talking about Xbox and all the other stuff. And I said, well, have you seen the Switch lately? And he goes, oh, no, Nintendo shot themselves in the foot with the Wii U. I don't focus on Nintendo anymore. I showed him the Switch video. He got to the point where he saw, you know, the taking Breath of the Wild outside. He goes, mm-hmm. Oh, okay, that's pretty cool. He lost his mind at Skyrim. Like, as soon as he saw Skyrim and he was like, you can take that with you, he lost his shit. Skyrim, so he was just sitting there going like, okay, no, I'm all in. I'm all in on this. And this target was targeted to 30-somethings like me. But then I go ahead and share that with, like, a kid. And then he's like, yeah, we're all in this. We're going to go get this. I'm going to tell my dad to get this for Christmas. Whatever. And you can bet that Activision's already looking at how they're going to get Skylanders on this thing. Right? I mean, they're already looking at how they can get young kids, you know.
He's right, though.
How they can get young kids into this thing, right? How they can get Skylanders on, you know, connecting with the Amiibo ports and all that stuff. Because they've already experimented with this. With Skylanders, like, how they can get Donkey Kong to switch between an Amiibo version and then the NFC version. And then how they can just twist them and then they can make them, like, for both. They're already there. So, you know, I think as soon as they market to adults, the kid market will take care of itself. Because when we were kids, did we like the stuff that was aimed at us? Or did we like the stuff that was aimed at, like, our parents, right? Things we snuck into
car radar. Insurance.
Can't wait. Allstate.
You know, like,
nationwide, it's on your side.
15 minutes can save you 15%. Oh no!
Hey man, all I gotta say is Peyton Sunday mornings is great.
Yeah, it is.
So here, well, and I have a thought on this, right. And I think that if you tell a kid. If you walk up to a kid and you say, something really cool is coming in 2 months, they're going to get excited and anxious, but and I'm speaking like with young kids, they want immediate. They live in the moment, right? They don't think about what's happening five months down the road. So, like, I don't think that hyping this for kids right now is going to do them any good. I think once the thing is on the shelves, release your, you know, your zany yokai, like I was Yo-Kai Watch, Pokemon, all of that. Release that marketing material. Run it on your Disney XD. Run it on your Cartoon Network during their, you know, child-focused blocks. Like, run that at those ad campaigns toward those kids. But as far as right now, like, who to market to, it is the... I really do think it's the people who read news, you know, who read gaming news. And there are kids that do that. Like, there are, you know, the preteens and teenagers who are getting into that and they're on message boards. But they're going to watch these games be played on a stream. Like, by a streamer, right? That's just, they're not going to news sites to consume. They're just wanting to see the gameplay. So I think at this juncture, pre-holiday, this is what they just need to be like, hey, be aware that this is coming in March. It does super scare me, though. The next E3 that we live through will be a post-NX launch E3. So I'm imagining Ubisoft coming on stage where they're like dancing giraffes
that again.
And then it's like they all have switches and they're just like locking them into the dock and they're like, shh, just dance, coming soon. And it's just like dancing with the...
Well, they've already confirmed Just Dance is coming over.
Or Beyond Good and Evil exclusively on Nintendo Switch.
Yeah, they won't do that. That's lost money.
That, for me, there is an easy answer to why they market it to adults.
We have to plan ahead to buy shit.
No, not that. I agree with everything you guys have said, but I think there's an easy reason. It's a 3DS.
Really?
And the 2DS. Particularly, you look at the 2DS, I believe that it's not necessarily they're trying to divert the Switch away from younger audiences, but from a progression standpoint, probably Nintendo board members are looking and saying, okay, you start your children on the 2DS. It's plastic. It's not this, like, it's one perfect screen. It's not folding. It's fully plastic, so kids, when they throw it around, they're not going to break. They have plenty of kid-friendly games. They have a huge lineup of games. There's no 3D. It's not going to hurt their eyes. As they get older, preteens, maybe teenager realm to some extent, you have 3DS. You get your 3D. You got your dual screens. All this extra functionality added in. Then as you get into the late teens, now you're starting, okay, late teens, going to college and whatnot, Switch. I think that, like, there's no point. What's the point in showing that ad with children? Say they do with children when you already have a device aimed at younger audiences, and that's the 3DS and the 2DS. They already have a slew of games that you want to play, Pokemon, Yo-Kai Watch, Super Mario. It's cheaper. Selling that to a parent, a kid selling that to a parent, is a lot easier than trying to sell them, hey, get the Switch. Now, are there exceptions to the rule? Yes. Do 12-year-olds play Call of Duty? Yes. They're like, there's not a difference there, but I think that if I'm sitting in a Nintendo boardroom and looking at, like, their behind-the-scenes, like, classified charts, I can easily see that we want children, when they start out, we want them to get a 2DS. They love it. Then they get older, they get the 3DS, they love it. Then they get the Switch when they get older. And they can actually start, like, if they start getting jobs, and like, oh man, you know, they like PlayStations and Xboxes, let me get the Switch.
The other thing is, as a parent, when I look at the Switch, I go, finally, I don't have to buy my child an iPad mini. I don't have to give them, like, an old iPhone. I don't have to give them, like, an iPad Pro, because some.
But then, how are they going to play Mario Run?
Let's see what I do. So I'll just go ahead and say, I'll get a Switch, right? And then I'll be like, here, Timmy, you know, here, I don't want you playing with these tablets because, you know, you can access to the internet and all the other things. It's not necessarily, I mean.
Let me go ahead and pause right there. I'm going to look at everyone here and people in the camera. If you're a parent and you're purchasing iPhones and iPads for your children,
you need to stop that shit.
Stop. Quit right now.
But Cameron.
No.
When they're yelling and they're grumpy and they're sad or something.
Guess what? You be a parent and you beat their ass.
Do you want me to get you the Switch again?
And it's the old. Okay.
Here.
You get good.
I do. Here. This is it. Words have power, but words have no meaning. We assign meaning to words based on our experiences. Example, 1965. When I get home, you're getting the Switch. Instills fear and dread into the child. 2017. When I get home, you're getting the Switch. Yay! Oh my God, we have the Switch. Did you get Zelda? Words have power, but no meaning.
That's pretty good. That's really good.
Or nowadays, you say you're getting them the Switch, and then you literally go get a Switch from a tree in the back and just teach them what for.
That's what I'm saying. Like,
it could still mean until the same thing.
Several days ago, the word Switch was a branch from a tree used for assaulting children.
Discipline, sir.
Disciplining children.
In my mind, it still means the same
Again,
thing.
Again, words have meaning. No. It depends on your own. But hey, the Switch is, it's a name.
Yeah.
I think this is, everyone's redoing everything now. I think Sony's doing pretty good as they are. Like, you know, they played and they won. You know, they played their hand and they won. Microsoft's rebranding a lot of things. Nintendo's rebranding a lot of things. We are looking at a lot of new stuff. New things. Stuff and things.
Like, I think Microsoft, the next round, when it comes to, like, Scorpio and everything else, we don't know what Sony has yet, but looks to be ahead of what Sony's making. And in terms of gaming consoles, which are eventually turning into PCs, I think that whatever the PlayStation becomes and whatever Xbox Scorpio is will become the Alienwares of our day, right? They'll be the specialized gaming PCs that people buy when they don't want to build their own. And then for the people who want to build their own PCs, they have their whole like gamut of things that they can do. And then there's a Switch that fits in sort of like that area between the whole game. It's an actual game console, right? Mm-hmm. It's an actual gaming thing that I plug in. I don't have to mod anything. I don't have to worry about two SKUs. I don't have to worry about any of that stuff. It is just
a console. Kids love SKUs.
As Nintendo has always done, Nintendo never plays by the rules of everyone else. When you grew up and when you got consoles, it was, I want the Nintendo whatever and mm-hmm. the Xbox system, or Nintendo whatever and the PlayStation system. It was, and I think that with the Switch, they're still going to do that. Like, people are going to get the Nintendo Switch and Xbox Scorpio.
Mm-hmm. Now, I will say this. If I can get all my AAA titles on the Switch, I will literally not get the next generation of consoles. I will just get the Nintendo.
What if
Switch? That's not gonna.
I don't know. No, if I can get all the big AAA titles that are like multi-platform and all that, if I can get my Destiny 2 on there, then yeah,
it that could happen. It depends on the dev kits for mm-hmm. the Switch.
Yep.
It looks like.
By the way, yeah. It's Tegra based, according to NVIDIA.
Oh, that's true. Yep. Yes.
And guess what? Tegra's based off of ARM. Yep. Guess what? Everybody writing for iPhones and Androids writing for
ARM.
Surprise!
I have two.
Can't wait for Castle Crashers on Nintendo Switch.
Ooh, Clash of Clans.
There you go.
Clash
of Clans. I mean,
that does imply that Pokemon Go and Miitomo and basically any mobile app could
be ported to it.
Makes total mm-hmm. sense.
But the CPU architecture is an ARM based. So I mean,
mm-hmm. we'll see.
In that respect, they win, because if you see that how mobile development is exploding, you tell an Android or iPhone developer that they can get their game on a Nintendo Switch by doing copy, save as, export dot Nintendo Switch, then yeah, sure, they're gonna do it, and you're gonna have tons of shovelware on that thing.
What I love,
just because you have a lot doesn't mean it's good.
What I love about Nintendo and the way they approach the market and the way they approach gaming is there is very much a sense of competition and almost a tribalistic stance to a lot of the console market, right? It's mm-hmm. are you the, and we joke about it here, right? Like I very obviously like, and the question, the unifier is like, if a game comes out on every console, which one do you buy it on, right? And that's your tribe, that's your group. And what I love about Nintendo is there is no win or lose. Like, it's Nintendo releases what they think are the best versions of their games they could make, right? And they focus on providing the best service they can to their thing. And I think that everyone does this. It's just that, like, Sony and Microsoft have to compete because they are in the same space.
Mm-hmm. Nintendo is the Switzerland of the video game
industry. Yes, they really are. It's like, hey, actually, we do nothing like anyone else in the world, and I think they're better for it. Like, I think that Nintendo games, you're not ever worried about quality, whereas we're constantly worried. Like, I would argue to say that more than 50% of the video games journalism industry is simply, is this game trash? Is Battlefield 1 garbage? Like, should I care about this game? There's no question. You should care about Nintendo games. Whether or not it's your type of game, totally up to you. You may be all about Smash, but Yoshi's Woolly World may not be for you, right? Like, that's a different target. But the thing that I love about Nintendo is I can't think of a time they released a game that wasn't good at what it was doing, right? Like, mm-hmm. you may disagree with, like, you may not be into this type of gameplay, but like, can anyone think of a time that on the Wii, specifically with the Wii U, that Nintendo launched a game that they made that was bad? I really can't think of one.
Not bad, but just not my type of game. Like Toad Treasure Tracker did.
Captain Toad.
The thing is, like Captain Toad, it's still a good game.
And the thing that I love about that, each of their games is you can about in two or three sentences describe. Toad's Treasure Tracker is a puzzle box game with a Toad skin on it. Whereas Super Smash Bros. Is a pseudo fighting game that's mm-hmm. more about the understanding the stage and the moves than it is about depleting your health, right? Mm-hmm. And so each of their games has that hook to it. And that's, again, I think that Nintendo is the strongest software lineup in the industry, period. No one else is as valuable as Nintendo. They just need to work on their other two pillars, and that Switch is a great move in hardware. We'll see on the services side.
So, but, yeah, I have a general rule when it comes to video games, or when it comes to console purchases. It has to have at least five, like, titles that I want that are exclusive to that system. So, around the table here, what are five games that, if the Switch launched with, is like an instant buy?
Oh, no, there's only one. Zelda.
Zelda Breath of the Wild.
That's it. That's all I need.
Zelda Breath of the Wild.
3D Mario.
Zelda Breath of the Wild. 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 Oh,
what else is needed? I mean, really?
Hey, no, if you,
and then by the time you've finished your 800-hour campaign in Breath of the Wild, there will be a new Mario Kart.
But look, that's going to be a $400 box for Zelda Breath of the Wild. Yeah. I already got a $400 box for like the Wii U, and if I'm getting Breath of the Wild, that's the only game I want. I'm probably going to just get it for the Wii U.
This thing plays Zelda Breath of the Wild.
It does.
I will be purchasing a Nintendo Switch to play Zelda Breath of the Wild.
Guess
like,
what?
It just goes to show that they like what they are bringing to the table with that game is... I think that Zelda games make Nintendo consoles, and that is a huge reason why I think the Wii U failed, is that they showed that demo footage, if you remember the conceptual footage, never came out. If that game had come out, they would have crossed 20 million.
The Wii
sales.
U was the only system that did not have an original Zelda game like on it during its life cycle.
Yeah. And like for
it's
me
got two ports.
Like from my personal perspective, I didn't enjoy Skyward Sword. So the last original Zelda game that I enjoyed playing was Twilight Princess. And I didn't enjoy that near as much as I did Wind Waker. So it was like Wind Waker was a peak for me on GameCube, and then it went down just a step, and I was like, oh, I can't wait to see. And then it was just like...
A Link Between Worlds was the best Zelda game they've made in a long time.
I mean, well, yeah, that's on the mobile platform. But like, I look at Breath of the Wild, and I'm like, okay, basically you went back to the original Legend of Zelda, OG Legend of Zelda, and now that's a full-fledged video game. Yep. Where does the credit card go? Where does that go? Here?
It's got a chip reader, man.
Do I put the money inside here? Do I just tape it to the amiibo and throw it into the sky and the carrier pigeon comes, picks it up and takes it to you?
No, you're Fulton it. You just sit there and go like, all right, we're going to Fulton my credit card.
That's it. Metal Gear Solid 5 Phantom Pain.
What if Metal Gear Solid 5 came title. Up for the Switch?
Yeah. Oh. No.
Yes.
No. Konami doesn't do game development.
Okay, so it'll be Konami's Metal Gear Survive. Dead to me. Okay, Metal Gear Survive comes out for the Switch.
You may see a Nintendo Switch like lock into a pachinko machine or something.
Oh, God. Wait. They could have Switches locking into different pachinko machines or arcades.
And that's, ladies and gentlemen, the rails.
Oh, my God.
All right. Go ahead and hit stop. That's it.
Bring it down. Man, we have had a good 90-minute conversation about the Nintendo Switch.
Mm. Yeah.
Final question. Will you buy one? Will.
When I first saw the design, like as he was sitting there playing with the Pro Controller or Joy-Con, whatever they're calling it, I was like, sold.
Okay. Cameron?
It took 5 seconds.
Okay.
When I hear more on hardware and price.
Okay. Cameron hates video games.
Chaz? Well, I'm with Cameron on this. I need to know about the price. I need to know about the hardware. I need to know the battery life, the games, and support.
I love
the concept, but it needs to have more than just Breath
of the
Wild.
I love video games, but No Man's Sky looked really good.
Right?
All three of them didn't say yes fast enough. Yes, I will purchase one. Yes, it will be amazing because here's the difference. Nintendo has a track record. And Nintendo will not do it unless they can do it at least correct in their vision, right? Like the Wii U wasn't great, but it was what they wanted. And so whether or not we think that's good or bad, I'm not going to pre-order one. But I am going to buy one the day it comes out. Actually, let's be real, I'll probably pre-order one. Especially if it comes with an amiibo.
No.
I want more information. I want to see a little bit more.
So we have two people with the correct answer and two without.
Yeah. Well, that's obviously.
Yeah. I mean, there's not an incorrect answer. I just like.
So Cameron, let me just, I thought we said this close enough to that answer to the question and then your answer, but maybe I need to say it again and then ask you. So let me try this again. Will you be purchasing a Nintendo Switch, period, Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild? Go.
Again, I will wait. Because, like, especially when you talk...
You don't have a Wii to play Breath of the Wild on.
Well, even with that, if... the Switch isn't one I necessarily want it to be, then guess what? I can buy a reduced priced Wii U with Breath of the Wild, potentially save money. So.
But the Switch is the best place to play Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild. That is what it is to you. That is what it is.
We will see when we get more information.
And I think it is great to have those questions, and we will be asking those questions here. And it was as we learn the answers to those questions, we'll talk about them right into these microphones. Right here.
So far, I think we've actually talked about the NX more than we have the Xbox or the PlayStation this year.
And again, this ends with Mario on his throne of bones.
His footrest is Master Chief's helmet.
How it ends, everyone.
His footrest is the Chief's helmet, but guess what? It's just a footrest.
It's like you're sitting in this room full of people and someone's eyes roll back in their head. Energy starts flowing all around them. They float into the air and start to spin around and they simply stop. Their eyes open up filled with light and they say, it all ends with Mario on his throne of bones. Fall to the ground. It's done. They don't remember anything. It's the prophecy. It has been spoken. The prophecy of video games is done. We know how it ends. How do we get there?
In the year of our Lord, 3018, Mario stood upon his throne of bones.
This was video games before the Switch.
Seth, what was life before the Switch?
No one knows. No one remembers. Didn't matter.
So it's going to be BS and AS before Switch and after Switch? Yes.
Or maybe PS, like post-Switch.
Okay.
So like something a little bit after Switch. Like.
Yeah, well, that'll work too.
That's an idea.
That's an idea for later.
So that's episode 43
yep.
of the Rocket Punch Cast. Thank you so much for joining us and listening. If you're on YouTube, thanks for watching. You can see our beautiful faces here. We have our new friend, Chaz.
Hey.
Who joined us for this first episode. Hopefully we'll have him back for more episodes. And we will see... a ton more information about the Switch coming out. As it comes out, we'll talk about it right here in these microphones on the Rocket Punch Cast. As always, you can head to rocketpunchgo.com to get all of our content. It is available free of charge for you right now. Go check it out. If you're listening to this the day it comes out, you are in the midst. You are currently experiencing Rocket Punch Halloween, which is our week-long Halloween celebration of video games. We're doing scary games almost every day. We're streaming on Tuesdays and Thursday of this week. So if you're listening to this Tuesday morning, get ready, because tonight we're streaming video games, the spoopy games, with lots of chills and thrills.
Ooh, that was good.
There's no tricks, just treats. I'm done. Turn the marketing off. But yeah, rocketpunchgo.com is where all that content lives. We'll be on Twitch at twitch.tv/rocketpunchlive. We are also on social media. On Twitter, we're at rocketpunchgo. Instagram is at RocketPunchGo and YouTube.com/RocketPunchGo. YouTube is where a lot of Halloween is going to be going on outside of the homepage, so definitely head over and check that out. But most importantly, if you're listening here, you're like, you know what, this is really awesome. I need more. 99% of the content that we make is offered free of charge for you across all those places, but what about the 1%?
What about the 1%?
Where is that? Well... that lives on patreon.com/rocketpunch. That's patreon.com/rocketpunch. There you can contribute as little as $1 a month to support Rocket Punch. The microphones, the everything you see, the lights, the camera, everything takes money. And right now we are doing this as a passion project, but every little bit that you give on patreon.com/rocketpunch is going to help us directly build this and grow this. If you, however, here's the... So you're like, wait a second, what about this 1% stuff? $5 or more gets you the bonus episode of the Rocket Punch Cast.
Not just one. You get all of them.
You get every one. We do one a month. You'll get this month's. You'll get last month's. You'll get every single one we've ever done. We will have those on the Patreon feed. You can go listen to them. And I have to say, they're pretty shenanigans filled. We're actually recording the next one after this. And the topic is going to... and it's going to be the most exciting topic we've ever had.
Oh, you mean Seth about the...
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Yes. Nice. I mean, as soon as we start, people are going to be on the floor.
Oh, that's going to be great.
It's going to be great.
It's going to be awesome.
So, anyways, as always, thank you so much for joining us. Wherever you are, like, subscribe, whatever the hell it is you need to do on that social media network to engage with it, do it. If you're listening just to the podcast, feel free to leave us a review on iTunes. That really helps us. We didn't get any Ask Rocket Punch this week, but if you have a question for us, hashtag Ask Rocket Punch, mention us on Twitter at Rocket Punch Go, and send that tweet to us. We will answer that question right here on the show, no matter how ridiculous it is. So send us those Switch questions. Send us those Red Dead questions. Send us those who would win in a fight between this and this questions. We will answer them. Who's the best video game console developer, period, or console manufacturer? It's easy to say Microsoft into the microphone.
I was going
to
say Neo Geo.
Until March.
Until March, then Nintendo. Anyways, thank you so much for listening, and as always, have a great week. Until next time, farewell.
Bye. See you guys.